thank you for the break and welcome back. I'd like to introduce our next speaker. Her name is Amina Mahrouch. She's a senior guidance, navigation, and control engineer at CesiumAstro, Inc., where she has worked for 2 years. She currently leads this GNC subsystem design, development, and integration efforts. Amina holds a BS in Aerospace Engineering from the Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University and is completing an MS in Aerospace Engineering focusing on dynamics and control. Please join me in welcoming her.
Hello, my name is Amina. I'm a GNC engineer at CesiumAstro with a background in aerospace engineering. Before I dive into the GNC design process, first I'm going to give a background on what Cesium is, what we do, what our goals are. Then I will dive into our SAT-1 overview, then the GNC subsystem design. I'm going to go over the components that we traded to buy versus make. And lastly, I'm going to give a brief overview on some of the simulation and analysis tools and how we implement them throughout the design process. So to start, Cesium essentially is a communication company founded in 2017 with the goal to make information easily accessible to everyone. We have our headquarters in Austin, Texas, and offices in Broomfield, Colorado, and El Segundo, California. So for those who are not familiar what a phased array is, generally you can think about it as an electronically stored array of antennas, which we can call elements, that create a beam of radio waves. And these radio waves are able to be steered electronically, meaning that you can point them in any direction over the field of view without having to physically move the antenna. So why is that significant? And I think the best way to answer that is by giving an example scenario. So take a spacecraft in a low Earth orbit and it needs to track some sort of moving target. So we can use an aircraft as an example. Using a traditional communication payload, we have to mechanically or physically change the direction that the beam is pointing using some sort of gimbal-like mechanism. Or changing the actual orientation of the spacecraft to maintain it locked on the target. However, if we use a active phased array, all we have to do is point the spacecraft in the general vicinity of the Earth, and the beam will be able to track the target electronically without having to mechanically move any platforms. With that being said, I bet now you're wondering, what is a GNC engineer, a guidance navigation engineer, and how do I fit in a communications company's roadmap? But before I answer this question, first, I want to identify the end goal of a product design cycle, which essentially is to achieve TRL 9, which stands for Technology Readiness Level 9. In short, achieving TRL 9 essentially says that the product has been on orbit, has performed to the specification that it is giving, and survives within, again, the specifications that are advertised. So when a startup wants to achieve TRL 9 or some sort of heritage, you need to get on orbit, and that's not an easy thing to do, especially if you don't already have flight heritage for the component, because most customers, especially in the space industry, don't want to take any risk because if it's expensive and time. And so Cesium, instead of relying on external customers or other missions to demonstrate the capabilities of our payloads, we decided to create an internal missions team. So our internal missions team essentially is tasked with the goal of designing an on-orbit testbed that can host a variety of Cesium payloads, past, future, current, at the lowest cost that we can do with really quick turnaround. And therefore, we can support the rapid development and continuation of the innovation of all of our payloads. The internal missions team also works very closely with our other offices in Austin, specifically the payload team, to continuously modify the test bed design and requirements. So this is where we get into SAT 1 overview. So tasks from above essentially is the test bed that I mentioned in the previous slide, which is in the form of a small satellite that can interface with any cesium payload. Another very important specification that I want to note in this slide especially is that we have to align with our company's naming policy. We have a very strict rule that we have to have very cool sounding bird names for all of our products. So one of our products, our first one that we launched, was our Nightingale active phased array, followed by Vireo. And we decided to go with Taito for our spacecraft bus. So many programs essentially are driven by high level requirements or first level requirements that identify what you're trying to achieve. However, since we're the internals missions team and Cesium is our customer, we don't have a customer that specifies exactly what we need to do. Instead, we got an objective. So the objective was to design an affordable LEO spacecraft that can host a variety of cesium communication payloads, have rapid turnaround, and can demonstrate inter-satellite communications. So building from that objective, the team then scoped the vision to create an initial level one requirements. So to include bounding the orbital definitions, we will create or design a spacecraft that is able to operate between 425 and 1200 kilometers circular orbit, given any inclination between 0 degrees and the sun synchronous, and be able to survive for 5 years. Additionally, we also define some baseline pointing modes, our primary being that the nadir or the payload phase points towards the Earth or nadir, with secondary pointing constraints of the solar panels that point towards the sun, and vice versa for our secondary pointing mode. And our third pointing mode is our safe mode, which essentially will point the solar panels towards the sun and rotate about that axis to continuously generate power. So I should note that the requirements of this bus, since we are our own customers and since our payloads are continuously being innovated and changing, we also are changing and increasing the design fidelity as we grow. And so one thing that is not actually mentioned in this slide that is very important to note is we go through various design reviews as we're building up to the final product, and through each of the reviews, there's different emphasis and stages that have to be met in milestones. Moving forward to the GNC subsystem, first we should actually define what GNC is. First, GNC stands for Guidance, Navigation, and Control. So this subsystem is responsible for answering a series of questions, starting with guidance. This essentially answers the question of what should we be doing, how do we achieve this, and so from there we can then identify the navigation part, which answers where the spacecraft is, where the spacecraft is pointing, so the orientation of the spacecraft with respect to some inertially fixed frame, along with the position and velocity of the spacecraft in, again, a well-defined frame. And the final part is the control. And essentially this says how we are able to achieve the guidance input that is requested from the GNC subsystem. So this can be implemented using various actuators to change the orientation and thrusters to change the orbit. So similar to Taito or our level one requirements, we can then derive our level two requirements, which typically are subsystem requirements. For GNC requirements, they're broken into our attitude determination and control requirements and the different accuracies required to satisfy our level one requirements, and then our PNT or position navigation and timing requirements. So if we start off with the attitude knowledge, which essentially refers to how well we know our attitude or our the orientation of the spacecraft's body frame with respect to some inertially fixed frame. Our requirement states that the spacecraft will know its orientation within 0.01 degrees about each of the body frames, which means three axis control, three sigma. So 99.7% of the time, we will know the attitude of the spacecraft within 0.01 degrees. So that's a very tight attitude knowledge requirement. And so the one way that we can accomplish this or comply with this requirement is to utilize star trackers along with some filtering techniques, specifically an extended Kalman filter and some sensor fusion using our onboard IMU. So moving on to our pointing accuracy, which refers to how well we can point the spacecraft or control the spacecraft with some with respect to some commanded direction. So our pointing accuracy is stating that we will be able to command or achieve pointing within 0.1 degrees of our targeted or commanded location, again, 99.7% of the time. And how we expect to comply with this requirement is using reaction wheels, which are a form of momentum exchange devices, along with a three magnetorquers, which we will use for momentum dumping. Again, I will cover that later in the presentation. So additionally, the third requirement is our rate knowledge, which essentially is exactly what it sounds like. How well do we know our angular velocity? And this one is stating that we will know it with a position less than 0.1 degrees per second about all of the body frames, so three axis, 99.7% of the time. And we're achieving this using an IMU sensor, which comprises of a gyroscope, which measures the angular velocity, and an accelerometer, which measures the linear acceleration of the spacecraft. It's one thing that's actually kind of interesting and important to know when it comes to rate knowledge. The rate knowledge not only affects how well we know the spacecraft's angular velocity or the acceleration, but depending on how well we know our rate can also play a factor on how well we can estimate the attitude of the spacecraft in the event of an off-nominal case that we can't use our star trackers or the other sensors fail. And also vice versa, in the event that we lose rate knowledge from our gyroscope, we're able to estimate our angular velocity using our attitude estimation. So that's an important thing to note. Moving forward is our bus agility requirements, which essentially specifies that we are able to change the orientation of the spacecraft from pointing in the nadir direction to pointing in the sun direction within 10 minutes. So here we have a TBR highlighted in red. And what that means essentially is that there is a value specified here, but it is not finalized, and further analysis is still required before we move on with this requirement. So TBRs are typically used when we have a value, but we're not sure yet, and we still need some more analysis. We need some sort of sign-off, where if we use a TBD, that typically means that we do not have a value or a statement chosen, but at some point we need to have one. Another thing to note about the bus agility, or at least why we have a TBR currently, is because we don't, all of the level two requirements for all the subsystems essentially are derived from the level one requirements. However, this specific one does not actually derive directly from our level one requirements. And so further analysis is still needed so we can modify it that way it is derived from level one and we are achieving some specific goal. And then the last requirement that is specified for attitude determination and control specifically is momentum management. So you typically want to have some sort of component that's able to maintain that the wheels don't saturate while in orbit. And this is, at least for LEO orbits, is typically achieved using magnetorquers, which essentially create a magnetic dipole moment that, when it interacts with the Earth's magnetic field, creates an external torque on the spacecraft that can maintain the angular rate of the spacecraft to a limit, to a threshold that the reaction wheels can handle. So moving on to our PNT position navigation and timing requirements, we start off with our timing knowledge, which in this case, we are specifying that we will know our timing knowledge within less than 10 milliseconds, again, 99.7% of the time. So the time knowledge is very important in many of our guidance algorithms, especially to propagate the orbit or the state of the spacecraft in the event that we don't have a GNSS measurement, or when we're modeling a magnetic field or trying to estimate the states or the position of velocity of celestial objects such as like the Earth or the Sun. Timing knowledge plays a huge role in any errors that are present in those estimations. Same thing with position knowledge accuracy and velocity knowledge accuracy, which we are saying that we will know our position knowledge within less than 50 meters all of the time, more or less, and our velocity knowledge within less than 1 meter per second all the time. Again, all three of these PNT requirements are being complied or expected compliance using a GNSS receiver, which I will talk about later in this presentation. But essentially, same as the time knowledge, the position and velocity knowledges also play a role in our modeled and estimated states, along with any error that can be present in our attitude knowledge, because the position knowledge, time knowledge, and somewhat velocity knowledge are used in some attitude determination algorithms to compute our attitude. And so if we are not within a specified accuracy, then we may not be able to meet the specific attitude knowledge requirements that we want. Moving forward to PNT. So kind of more higher level, GNC can be broken down into two main subsections. So there's the PNT section, which is the position, navigation, and timing. And then the other portion is the attitude determination and control, so ADC. The role of the PNT side is essentially to estimate or propagate the spacecraft state, and this can be in the form of reading a GNSS measurement and then transforming that measurement to some sort of useful state, or we can use the an orbit propagator to estimate the state, given that we know our initial orbital elements. Before, I guess, you can see that we have GNSS receiver and GNSS antenna. So just kind of a note, the GNSS receiver, which stands for the Global Navigation Satellite System, is the hardware that is actually used to get these measurements. And this hardware uses the global positioning system, which we're familiar with, the GPS, which is the service that's provided by the US military. The GNSS antenna is where the signal is actually received, where the GNSS receiver acts as a sort of processing unit that converts the measurements into something more useful. So typical outputs from a GNSS receiver are in the form of LLA, so latitude, longitude, and altitude, or some sort of Earth-centered, Earth-fixed frame. And lastly, depending on our timing knowledge requirements or how precise we need to know our timings for different operations, we can then implement a chip scale atomic clock, or CSAC for short. And so that will be able to give us a tighter timing knowledge accuracy versus the GNSS receiver or any propagated states that we attempt to make. Now, the first section of the ADC components is the attitude determination part of the GNC subsystem. So this is essentially responsible to estimate both the attitude, so the orientation of the spacecraft's body frame with respect to a well-known inertially fixed frame. It is also responsible for estimating the spacecraft's angular velocity. So depending on the attitude requirements that are specified in the level two, we can use a variety of sensors and a variety of techniques to estimate our attitude. There are two main, There are two main attitude approaches that we can use, one of which is coarse attitude estimation, which essentially is what it sounds like. Coarse attitude, meaning not as precise, typically in the order of about 5 degrees knowledge. And a very popular technique that is used to estimate coarse attitude is triad. And that stands for triaxial attitude determination. So how this works is it requires two body vectors, which are sensor measurements and body frame components. A typical configuration of these two body vectors are in the form of a magnetic field measurements from the three-axis magnetometer and a sun vector estimate from either a fine sun sensor or a number of coarse sun sensors. Another requirement for the triad algorithm is two corresponding inertially fixed vectors. So this is when our PNT measurements and accuracies play a role. First, to complement the body frame, the sun vector has to be calculated in the inertial frame. So we know where the sun is located with respect to our body, but we don't know where it is in inertial. And like I mentioned before, our attitude is our body frame orientation with respect to some inertially fixed frame. So we can calculate the sun's position or estimate it as a function of our current time or epoch. And this can be done by first assuming that we have a sun-centered ecliptic frame and estimating the Earth's position and velocity in that frame as a function of the time. So using the time input to compute the orbital elements, taking those orbital elements, converting those to position and velocity. And since it is a sun-centered frame by take that is pointing towards the center of the Earth by taking the negative sign of that pointing vectors, we can then assume that that position vector, if it's centered at the Earth, so changing the orientation, is now an Earth-centered ecliptic plane pointing towards the sun. So that means we just converted those vectors to a position and velocity estimate of the sun's location in an Earth-centered ecliptic plane. So throughout all of GNC, I guess this is kind of a tangent, but it's frame definitions, both coordinate frames and time frames, play a huge role in all calculations, algorithms, and models that are implemented. So when I say Earth-centered, for example, that means that the frame, the three-axis frame, the origin of that is in the center of the Earth, and vice versa, sun-centered and any other celestial body or object. So body frame of the spacecraft is fixed in some orientation along the body frame axes of the spacecraft, typically centered at its center of mass. So when I say body to inertial, that means the relative orientation of the body frame relative to the inertial frame. So just kind of like a side thing. So now that we have the sun states in Earth-centered ecliptic frame, we had to convert that to an Earth from the Earth-centered ecliptic plane to an Earth-centered equatorial plane using the ecliptic angle. So again, kind of high level background, the ecliptic frame is the plane of the Earth's orientation about, the Earth's rotation about the sun, where the equatorial plane is essentially the equator of the Earth, which is where an Earth-centered frame is typically aligned to. And the angle between these two frames are the plane that we are rotating the sun about, and the equatorial plane is well-defined and well-known, and we know that that angle is the ecliptic angle. And so we're able to convert this position and velocity estimate of the sun vectors from this ecliptic to an equatorial plane. And so that sometimes is more than likely called the Earth-centered Earth-fixed plane, which means Earth-centered Earth-fixed, yeah, which rotates as the Earth is rotating about its spin axis, where an Earth-centered inertial frame essentially is inertially fixed and therefore does not move as the Earth is rotating about its spin axis. So similar to how we just estimated the sun vector to correspond with our body frame sun measurement from the core sensors, we also have to estimate or calculate the inertial vectors of the magnetic field function, and that will be as a function of our time input along with our spacecraft state. So this is a little bit more complex than the previous calculations, so I'm not even trying to explain it, and also yields lower accuracy, so it's not as accurate. Same thing with the magnetometer, typically depending on the hardware you're using, is not as accurate as the sun sensors. So we're able to estimate the sun's states a lot better than we're able to estimate the Earth's magnetic field and inertial frame. And so when you're using a triad frame, you typically want to align your triad frame, the frame that you're creating, along your most accurate vector. So our first component of the triad frame will align with the sun vector in both the body and inertial. And then to compute the second part of the triad frame, you take the cross product of the magnetic field or the second body and inertial vectors, separate frames, and along with the first and the second, and normalize that. And that will be your second component of the triad frame. Then you complete the right-hand coordinate system to create the triad frames. So now at that point, since we created a body frame triad frame and the inertially fixed triad frame, we can estimate our inertial to triad attitude or rotation matrix along with our body and triad rotation matrix. So essentially, how much do we have to change the body frame to align with this triad frame and vice versa? So if you're familiar with linear algebra and matrix math, you know that if we multiply and triad to body rotation matrix with a inertial to triad rotation matrix, we can end up with an inertial to body rotation matrix, essentially the way that we are estimating our attitude. This typically will yield accuracy plus or minus about around 5 degrees or so. Again, it really depends on how accurate and noisy your sensors are and how well you know your position and time. Moving forward, the other component of attitude determination that we can use is fine attitude estimation, which typically is a lot more precise and in the order of about 0.01 degrees accuracy. And this also requires more sophisticated instruments, which is why we have two star trackers on board. So unlike other sensors that are typically used in a GNC subsystem, star trackers output an attitude already because it uses photos of different stars and a star catalog to estimate the star tracker frame with respect to the inertial, which we can then convert to body frame with respect to inertial and vice versa, since we know the orientation of the star tracker given that we mounted it on the bus. So it's to add more accuracy to this estimation, we can implement an extended Kalman filter to this estimation, and using the sensor fusion techniques and an IMU, we can increase the accuracy of our attitude determination or how well we know our body with respect to an inertial frame orientation using these methods. The next part of the ADC system is the attitude control portion. So this is essentially responsible for calculating the required actuator commands that will either modify the spacecraft's orientation, again, with respect to some well-known frame, giving some type of guidance input or attitude error or commanded operational modes. For instance, we can talk about BDOT, which is implemented right when we are when a spacecraft is dispensed from the launch vehicle. When you're dispensed, typically there's some sort of angular velocity about each axis that the spacecraft encounters, and the goal is to use magnetors, or at least in LEO, low Earth orbit, since the magnetic field strength is high enough that the dipole, which again interacts with the magnetic field of the Earth, is able to produce a torque capable of reducing the spacecraft's angular velocity. And so the BDOT algorithm takes the change in the magnetic field measurements and uses that to compute the required dipole that the magnetorquer will produce by sending a current through it that will then act on the spacecraft in the opposite direction of the angular velocity. So there's a BDOT gain, which is a negative KB dot, and that's the control algorithm that we also implement to make sure that the rates are dampened. So what we consider detumble is getting to an angular momentum of the spacecraft that the wheels can handle and adding some sort of safety margin to that. So angular momentum, if you look at it strictly from an equation standpoint, it's the moment of inertia multiplied by the angular velocity. And so by decreasing the rate, we're decreasing the angular momentum. One, I guess, down part on using momentum exchange devices, which are reaction wheels. Background on what reaction wheels are, they're essentially, so for magnetorquers, that produces an external torque about the spacecraft when it interacts with the magnetic field, where reaction wheels, as it says in the name, momentum exchange device, produces an internal torque and is able to store some of the momentum. So if you think about it somewhat like Newton's laws, where it says equal and opposite reaction force, this is essentially what's happening. But one downside of reaction wheels is they're able to get saturated if the angular momentum of the spacecraft is greater than what the wheels can handle. And that's when we employ our magnetorquers, which can, again, lower our rates, which lowers our angular momentum and can desaturate the reaction wheels. That way, we will continuously have control authority, three-axis control authority, using the wheels. So how I don't know how to fix that. Is it better?
I hear you. Is the YouTube still doing all right?
Can you get something else for us?
Hello? Better? No, maybe?
Yep. All right. Good. All right. I think we're good.
No? Cool. So I guess higher level and kind of moving forward, the reaction wheels are typically controlled using some sort of feedback control loop, so a closed loop control system that takes in some error in our commanded versus actual attitude estimation and then calculates a motor torque that we can then convert to whatever value the reaction wheel will take in. So that can be a torque command, a speed command, or a current command. And so we can change the orientation of the spacecraft by implementing an internal torque. Additionally, we can also maintain that the wheels are not saturating by using the rods, as mentioned before. And then we can use a feed-forward loop to continuously dump momentum as we're reading in the reaction wheel speeds and estimating the spacecraft's angular momentum. So moving forward, this slide is essentially meant to say that this is not a unique design approach for the GNC subsystem, and that's not essentially what I'm here to show or what I'm here to design. The GNC subsystem, especially for LEO orbits, have a very common architecture, and depending on your level one requirements or your level two requirements, those drive the types of actuators and algorithms and sensors that are deployed. So given that our attitude knowledge requirement was so low, that was automatically a given that we will have star trackers on board to achieve that very tight attitude knowledge requirement. Similarly, we chose a three-axis control strategy. That easily means that we will need some sort of momentum exchange devices. And so higher level I wanted to mention here is more time was spent in trading the physical sensors and the actual components. And what I mean by that is, what performance do I need from this component to achieve this requirement? And less so in reinventing the wheel and trying to come up with an optimized architecture of the GNC subsystem. But that being said, this is the GNC system architecture. So the GNC system, which will achieve all of the requirements that we're giving in the first couple of slides, is equipped with 8 coarse sun sensors, which we will talk about more later, a 3-axis magnetometer, 2 star trackers, an IMU. I have gyroscope in between because I am an attitude person and I think about attitude, until I realized that we also have to do some orbit maintenance and collision avoidance. So pretend there's accelerometer inside those brackets, because that's also what's equipped in the IMU. We have 4 reaction wheels, one of which is redundant, the 3 magnetors, each aligned with the spacecraft's body frame, the antenna and the receiver for the GNS subsystem, and 1 CSAC in the event we need to do very, very precise timing experimentation in any way. So another trade that we had to go through before deciding on the components is, first, we baseline all of the components that we want to buy. These are all the components, and then we separated these components by their cost, the lead time, the complexity, and severity of the components. And what I mean about that is, how much does this component cost? How long will it take for me to get this specific component in my hands and be able to integrate it and test it? The complexity is, how complex is this component? And what I mean by that is, when you look at a star tracker compared to a coarse sun sensor, the complexity is day and night. Star tracker's algorithm and hardware, and even just the lens and testing the lens and making sure that the lens doesn't fail on orbit, and some ways that can fail would be due to radiation effects. So the lens can darken or yellow or distort because of either solar radiation or different types of radiations that can affect the actual lens of the star tracker, which, depending on the level of damage the lens goes through, will at the very least decrease the accuracy that the star tracker can measure, if not completely disregard all of its measurements. So that's what I mean about complexity. And then the last thing that we wanted to take, well, that I took into account, is essentially, how critical is this component? For example, if this component fails, does this mean mission failure? Do we rely on it so much to not only survive, but to perform any of our functions? And if it fails, are we done? So Taking that into account, the more complex, most expensive, and highest lead time components are our wheels and our star trackers. And so to be as risque, we decided to buy those components, at least for our first couple of satellites. And then we decided to entertain the idea of designing and building some of the more simpler, less complex components, which are the core sun sensors and the magnetors. So those are our main components. So our core sun sensors, before anything, I just want to talk about how when you're designing a product for the first time, especially if you've never done it before, there are different stages that you go through in the design process. The first one is essentially having an idea and putting it into CAD. And in the picture that you see, the left-hand model of our sun sensor is the first ever configuration that we came up with. And so from there, we were able to change the design and modify it to meet different specifications, mechanical specs, environmental, et cetera, and reduce its size and volume to the second one. And then one idea that we entertained is potentially having an exposed PCB and having some of the electronics on the outside to reduce the complexity of integration, since again, this is our first model and we're integrating and building in-house, which as of last week is no longer the design, and we're moving towards putting it back inside the pyramid. So background of our CSS, or the design that we decided to use, is a pyramid configuration of four COTS, or off-the-shelf photodiodes, that have previously flown. So we know that they can survive. We know that they're rated to a LEO environment. For our first demo mission, we're planning on flying two pyramid configuration with four photodiodes each. So these are where the diodes essentially live. And then there's a cover glass to make sure that the diode does not saturate or there's no damage to the sensor throughout the 5 years requirements that can essentially make our component fail. With that being said, to be as risk as averse as we can possibly can, we're also baselining another sun sensor component to fly alongside with ours. And that way, since this is our first flight, we're able to ensure that the sun sensors on board are performing to within specs whilst testing our own designs and configurations and making sure that it does everything that we say it does, and hopefully more. And so the process of designing and kind of coming up with these components and test campaigns, et cetera, is a little, I guess, non-conventional when it comes to aerospace, especially old space, but we're taking a one step at a time approach. So instead of defining every single task that needs to be accomplished during every week, month, et cetera, instead we're identifying milestones that we want to reach and then identify what it means to reach these milestones and complete this milestone. And each of the milestones are scheduled for a specific time in order to meet our first launch and have them go on orbit and get tested and see their performance. So the milestones that we came up with, the higher level, essentially start with a prototype. So before anything, let's get a working prototype, a physical prototype that we can hold, we can test, and we can mess around with and see if we want to make any modifications before we come up with the engineering unit. So an engineering unit is essentially the same component that we will fly, except it hasn't been tested and verified that it will survive space environment. So it's a less intense version of the component. And from there, after testing, modifying, and working with the component, we then work our way up to a flight unit. So a flight unit essentially means that this will pass, this is going to survive the mission lifetime, and this will do exactly what is spec'd out to do. And of course, something that I forgot to mention in the beginning, before we went through any of these designs, we started off with level one requirements, which were, again, derived from the level one requirements of the tidal bus. Since we want to implement these core sun sensors in current and future buses, we want them to also meet the specs that are required to satisfy that requirement. So similarly, on the other hand, we have our magnetorquers. So the magnetorquers are a little bit different, and because we started them a little bit earlier, and so our first prototype has already been completed, and there's a picture of it right there. It's not the magnetic dipole moment that we currently are aiming for, but it is a version, and it looks awesome. So I'm really excited to see our engineering unit in the next few weeks or months. So one thing that's kind of important to note when designing a magnetorquers, aside from, of course, the performance, temperature, et cetera, is coming up with a duty cycle. So when using the magnetorquer, if the magnetorquer is on, there's a current being run, and there's a magnetic dipole that is outputting, then the magnetometer sensor should not be reading any measurements. So in order to read any measurements, we need to make sure that the rods are not firing and vice versa. So when the rods are firing, magnetorquers are not measuring. And when the magnetorquers are not measuring, the rods are firing. And so this is identifying a duty cycle, which a typical one for magnetorquers that I've seen is around 75%. And what this says is the rod will fire, will create a magnetic dipole moment 75% of the time, while the magnetometer is measuring 25% of the time. So that's an interesting consideration, especially trying to come up with exactly what duty cycle would work and meet all the specifications. Some additional, I guess, performance specs to take into account is making sure to identify your saturation limits, which means not saturating the core, along with different performance. Moving on to our mission simulations. So for our mission simulations, we they're typically used for a variety of analyses, specifically to test and simulate different scenarios that we can expect on orbit and to verify and test our flight software algorithms. So to validate the algorithms, to validate that we're meeting these accuracies that we're advertising. Additionally, we can also use our simulation to size our hardware. And what I mean by that is calculating the performance specs that we need to achieve these pointing accuracy requirements. So when it comes to our reaction wheels, we want to know what momentum storage that we need or the torque that we need in order to meet the pointing accuracies. Same thing with the magnetors, what dipole moment do we need in order to not only detumble the rods, but also to ensure that the wheels are not saturated, and so on and so forth. Other use cases for the mission simulation is also to simulate different operational modes and see if there are any anomalies that we can expect and how we can change that or fix that or test out different fault states and algorithms. So for us at Cesium, we use a simulation software, the Python-based library called Basilisk, which is an open source software developed by the Autonomous Vehicle Systems Lab at CU Boulder, which essentially models all of the hardware components and flight software in C and C++, and is swigged to create these Python modules, and you're able to implement these C models into your Python scenario and simulate what the spacecraft essentially will see on orbit, given some high and low fidelity. Additionally, the Avius Lab also implemented a 3D visualization software, which is called Wizard, and that way you're able to see different ground locations, different spacecrafts within an orbit, and from the larger circles, essentially, that's the field of view of the spacecraft at that area, given the modeled active phase array. So moving on to that is talking about our flatsat integration. So higher level, what a flatsat is essentially the engineering units. So the not flight models necessarily, but the same components that we are planning to fly. And so by building a mini version of the spacecraft, we're able to test a variety of things on orbit and get familiar with different components. So how we decided to kind of integrate our simulation and our flight software, which I should have mentioned in the previous slide. We're designing our simulation software to essentially mimic what we expect our flight software to look like. And what I mean by that is all of the components are modeled. However, there's also interfaces that take in the sensor frame measurements and convert that to a useful data input, and so on and so forth when it comes to attitude determination, estimation, controllers, and guidance. So we developed a Python-based Basilisk module called Basilink, which essentially is used to read messages from the environment, the dynamics, and mock hardware that I just mentioned in Basilisk, and then uses that to read and write that telemetry through a socket, which again, that goes into a shared memory that can be both read and written from the CFS software. So the CFS software is essentially a NASA developed software framework that simplifies the flight software development process by more or less providing the infrastructure. And using that, we are able to use the similar, if not identical, flight software that we've written in C in our simulation and convert that to actual flight software that can then be tested and used on orbit. So high level, I guess, to kind of close this out is there, this was more or less like the highest level, just surface level GNC overview, and there's a lot more complex testing and analysis and throughout the whole design process, including for our simulations. So for example, I didn't mention any of the estimation techniques or Monte Carlo simulations that should be used and implemented in order to try to predict the unpredictable, more so in terms of what failures can occur, essentially how often can this failure occur? What can we do to ensure that we can survive from this? And any fault that occurs essentially has a safe mode or some sort of backup mode to autonomously make sure that both the spacecraft, GNC subsystem, and all of the components are safe and performing at their nominal states. So with that being said, thank you.
All right, thank you, Amina. We're a bit out of time, so we'll just do a couple of quick questions from online, after which are you fine with sending you the remaining questions, and then you can answer them at your leisure in the email.
I'm sorry, I missed everything you just said.
We have just enough time for a couple of quick questions, and the remainder we will send to you via email, and you can answer them when you can. So a question from online is that, are your antennas meant to be used in CubeSats? And what drove your choice to develop a small sat instead of a largest CubeSat?
That's a really good question. To answer the first one, not necessarily designed for CubeSats specifically, but they can be used on a CubeSat and have flown on CubeSats. We have a variety of different sizes of payloads and continuously developing more. So yes and no, more or less. The main driver for the small sat is essentially being able to create these baseline spacecraft that we would use for a variety of our payloads. And that means larger ones, different ones, multiple ones, etc. And so a small sat is able to accommodate more components that we can test on orbit compared to a CubeSat, which is very limited. Another driver, I guess, that I didn't point out when I was talking about all the great things about active phased array is it's also very power hungry. And so a small sat, we're able to have these huge arrays and the equivalent actuators that are able to maintain the stability of the spacecraft and the control authority required to change the orientation for all of the operational modes. So those are kind of, I guess, higher level why we went with a small sat class and kind of skipped over the CubeSat.
Okay, one last question. The chipset The chip scale atomic clock requirement is surprising. Could you just use a GNSS disciplined oscillator?
A disciplined oscillator?
Yes.
I'm not exactly sure what that is completely.
Okay, we will get back to you with that through email. We're just out of time right now. I'd like to thank you once again for the presentation.